Hello everyone, welcome back to the Geekquilibrium Speak Geek Podcast. We are your hosts, Movie Master Mike.
And Tabletop Tim.
And we are back and better than ever with,
oh, yeah,
with all kinds of stuff to talk about today. We've said before, we record on Thursdays, so tonight Batman v Superman comes out, so we won't have a chance to talk about that until next week.
Right.
But we didn't even mention this in the last 4 weeks, but Daredevil came out last week, so we both got a chance to watch it, so we'll be talking about that. We have just a few bits of movie news, a little bit of board game news. Do you have a board game to talk about today?
I do.
All right, well, we'll get into that, and then we both have a bit of fan casting to do today, is that right?
That is correct.
All right, yeah, because we've mentioned this 3 of the last 4 weeks that we've recorded, the Ghostbusters reboot,
right?
And we just keep bringing it up, and I just think it's, because I was listening to, and when I was editing the podcast, how we talked about how it's a really interesting idea that they changed it to all women, so I thought it'd be a cool idea if we took an existing franchise that was mostly male and did what Ghostbusters did and do a gender bender and fan cast it as all women. So that's what we both set out to do this week. So usually I spend loads of time doing fan casting, so I had to do this, you know, pretty quick this week.
Yeah, I didn't realize how much time it takes.
Oh, yeah, because you have to look at all kinds of the actresses and actors, you know, like, do they fit?
I didn't realize how few actors' names I knew. I've seen this movie a dozen times, and then I'm like, I don't know who the fuck anyone is.
Yeah, it's hard. It's definitely hard. And it's hard to just not do, like, oh, well, Robert Downey Jr. is good, and The Rock is good, and, you know, not to go straight to the mainstream guys. Try to get people that, you know, people know. You don't want to just do, like, oh, that one girl that was in that one movie from, 5 years ago, it was an indie movie. It's like, well, nobody... Okay, you know. But, so yeah, that's what we're going to do, and let's get right into it. The movie news, not tons happening, but, because like I said, you know, the biggest movie news will be Batman v Superman is coming out. And there's lots of news about what all the characters look like. Did they do it right? Did they do it wrong?
They're already doing reviews on it.
Yeah, and I'm trying to stay away from all that, you know, because I don't want to, we're going to see the movie before next week, so we're going to be talking about it next week, but we did get a set photo from the Wonder Woman movie. It's not a set photo, it's like a promo photo.
Right.
And it's of her and the three women that train her. I think it looks pretty good. It's really, it's not quite Zack Snyder-y with the coloring and the, you know, the epic look of the picture, but it's kind of like that. It looks almost like Zack Snyder could have taken this picture.
I don't know. I feel like it is. I mean, if you go back to 300,
there
was a lot of color muting
that
they did in that film, and this photo kind of looks like that.
Yeah, it looks enough like it to where it looks like they're trying to stay within his vision that he's already established with two movies already.
Right.
So, but it looks cool. I mean, what's her name? Gal Gadot. I think she looks great as Wonder Woman. She looks phenomenal. Everyone, when they first cast her, everyone was like, oh, she's too thin. She has no meat on her bones. You should have cast Gina Carano, who was in the Deadpool movie.
Right.
Because she's
The Rock.
Yeah, or The Rock, exactly. But if you go back to the comic books, it wasn't until somewhat recently that they made Wonder Woman more buff.
Kind of muscular.
Yeah, muscular and stuff. Because, like, if you go back to the original comics, like, she's just a normal woman that they drew, you know.
Yeah.
And just like Superman, like, everyone thought, like, oh, Superman has to be this big, bulky guy. It's like, well, not really. He's super powered. He doesn't have to be muscly, you know, because he has super strength. It could be just a guy, you know. They don't have to be buff. I mean, they have to be, you know, in great shape.
Yeah.
So casting a thin woman's like, that looks just fine. Like, she looks great.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. Why does Superman have muscles anyway, right? Because muscles are built for resistance. And really, there's nothing on the planet that...
what does he do to work out?
Nothing.
Yeah.
Like, he could push entire buildings up with no effort. So
yeah,
there's really no muscle being built, so I don't know where that comes from. But
yeah, exactly.
He should really be just like a Joe the Plumber-looking kind of guy, but...
Yep. Like, Chris Reeves, I thought, was perfect as him.
Right.
You know? But yeah, this photo, you get to see the three women that basically raise and train Wonder Woman in this photo, and they're on, like, a beach with all these cool rocks and cliffs and stuff, and...
Yeah, and I like the costumes. It's not crazy bright like the comic book.
Right, yeah. Costume. I definitely like how she's not wearing red, white, and blue.
Yeah, and I don't think that would transfer very well. I don't know. I like the Spider-Man costume. I mean, that's something that works for the bright colors.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think it works so much for the Wonder Woman. If you go back to the Wonder Woman television show.
Oh, God.
And you got the bright costume. I don't think it will really work in a cinematic world today.
Yeah, no, I don't think so either. But I know from the comics, she doesn't wear red, white, and blue until she comes to America. She kind of does that in honor of being here. Like, if she were to have gone to, like, Brazil, she would have been wearing yellow and green. Like, she does that in honor of, like, you know.
Awful.
Yeah, but she does that kind of in honor, like, you know, like, I am a guest here, so I'm going to wear your colors. And
okay.
So that's kind of what, but, you know, in this, everyone's wearing, like, gold.
Do you know Wonder Woman was created by the guy who created the polygraph?
I might have known that. That sounds familiar, so yeah.
I'm not sure of his name, but yeah, he was and also a polygamist. So he's really, like, forward-thinking and really into
bondage.
Well, he wasn't a bondage.
Yeah, because in almost every issue,
she
is captured and tied up and in peril. So, yeah, she's always tied up.
Bondage. Yeah. But he was also a feminist, which is what derides the strong female character. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think there was any female superheroes before Wonder Woman.
Probably not. She might have been the first, or at least the first mainstream that got her own book.
Right.
That might have been, like, you know, like Catwoman was probably around, you know, maybe around the same time, but I don't know the lineage of Wonder Woman very much, so I've never really been interested in her. But this photo, and there was one other set photo that came out a couple weeks ago of her and Chris Pine, who was in the Wonder Woman movie, and they're in, like, 1930s, like, suits, you know, like, on set. Because it's supposed to be, or not the 1930s, it's World War I, so, like, you know, the 19-teens. I forget where I was going with this, but I think the suits look good. They look good. Wonder Woman, she's wearing the least amount of clothing of these four women.
Well, she's got to move around a lot.
Yeah. But they all look like warriors, they all have weapons. Two of them have swords, one has a spear, the other one has a bow and arrow, it looks like. But the one with the bow and arrow, the picture is very small, and if I enlarge it, it just gets grainy.
Yeah.
But the one on the right, it almost looks like Katie Sackhoff, but you can tell it's not once I enlarge it. But from far back, it's like, oh, that could be Katie Sackhoff.
What's Katie Sackhoff in?
Battlestar Galactica.
Oh, Starbuck. Yeah, unfortunately, she hasn't been in enough. Last thing I saw her in was the Riddick movie.
Yeah, Riddick, yeah. Yep. That was the last thing I saw her in,
too. We got to see a lot of her.
Yeah.
But that's the last thing I can remember seeing her in.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, it'd be great to see her in other stuff. It would be cool if she was in this movie, but I don't think she is.
Yeah.
But I don't know who the other women are, and I'm sure I could look it up. The photo, I think it looks pretty cool. It shows you that, you know, it's going to take place at least a little bit in her on her home turf before she comes to America during World War I. But yeah, it looks good. Anything else you want to say about Wonder Woman?
Not in particular. I don't know a lot about the story.
Yeah, I know the original story was World War II, and they changed it to World War I for the movie. I don't know exactly why, but personally, I like World War I more than World War II, only because of the overexposure of World War II. And our next bit of news is Indiana Jones 5 has been announced, and it will be Steven Spielberg, and it will be Harrison Ford. And it is going to be written by David Koepp. I think that's how you say his name. It may be Cope, but I think it's Koepp. But anyway, it's...
And David Koepp was the writer for Jurassic Park.
Yes, he wrote Jurassic Park.
Have they announced any of the plot? Has that even been...
Not that I've seen. I think it's just they announced the director and the actor are coming back. It's not going to be a reboot. It's going to be another indie movie. It's Indy 5, not let's redo Indy for today.
They should just make Indiana Jones 4.
Yeah, they should.
We'll just forget about Kingdom of the Crystal Skull and move along.
There's a few things I actually really like about that movie.
Really?
Yeah, I really like the motorcycle chase scene through the school. That was really fun.
Sure, okay, I get that.
I don't mind Shia LaBeouf, especially as his son, as a greaser in the 50s. I thought it worked very well. The scene where they're having a drink together, and Shia LaBeouf steals the beer off the thing,
and then he
puts it back, and then they start the fight, you know, get the greaser! Like, that was really fun, which started the motorcycle chase scene. Changing it to Russians makes sense in the 50s, you know, the Cold War or something. There's a lot of great ideas about that movie, but really once they get to the jungle, it just falls apart.
Oh, it totally falls apart.
Yeah, and then, the whole beginning scene, it started off kind of well, with in the warehouse, you know, he does the whip and he swings and he falls into the truck.
Into
he's like,
the
you
truck.
Know, like, I thought that was closer or whatever. You know, that was great, but once he got to the nuclear testing site, it got really stupid, really quick.
Yeah, I'll agree with you. I like the bits of the first half. I think I've kind of
blocked it.
Blocked it out because I hated the end so much.
It was so... pretty much once they get to the jungle, there are a few good scenes. Like when they get to the jungle and they're still looking for John Hurt, his character, and they go to like his jail cell and they see like he was scratching things and writing things. Like there's a few good things. So they mention the young Indiana Jones show because they were talking to the locals and Shia LaBeouf's like, he's like, I took Spanish for a couple years in school, but I didn't understand a word that lady said. He's like, oh, it's a certain dialect. I learned it from Pancho Villa when I was riding with him. He's like, Pancho Villa, bullshit. And he's like, no, really. Like, you know, I rode with him for a little bit. And in the Young Indiana Jones show, you see him with Pancho Villa. So it's cool that they harkened back to the Young Indiana Jones show.
Right.
But so I think right after that is when it just completely falls apart. And I hate everything after that. The swinging through the jungle with monkeys and everything CG and the ants. And the waterfall scene with it's so stupid.
The CG was brutal in that movie.
Yeah.
What made Indiana Jones, the first one, so amazing was like all the practical effects, all the stunts.
Yeah.
I mean, I know at the end you had the claymation faces melting apart, but that's still a practical effect.
Yeah, oh yeah. I saw a recreation of that. Like they recreated that effect, and it's all these layers on like a fake head.
Uh-huh.
And then they like blow heat onto it and it melts away. And like the one that they have in the movie looked better than even what they did now. It was just perfect in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it was a practical effect. It wasn't CG melting face, you know.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff you can't do with practical effects, but for the most part I think they always look good. I mean, get a great action scene out of practical effects if you go to movies like Hellboy 2.
Oh yeah,
you can have a great fight scene with a giant monster and it's a puppet.
The jungle scene where Shia LaBeouf is, you know, sword fighting Cate Blanchett on the two jeeps. Like,
it
could have been so good. Like, you have Steven Spielberg. He's a phenomenal director. Even in today's age, he's a great director. The practical effects and the practical stunts that he did with Indiana Jones in that truck scene in the first one where he's under the truck, you know, like, climbing on the side. Like, it's so good and practical. It's like, why couldn't you and George Lucas and all your money go to a road in a real jungle, go to Hawaii, find a road, and film an awesome stunt on the side of a road?
People
like,
did that shit for years.
Yeah.
Decades.
And like, it's like, why couldn't you have done it?
Yeah, you have to do everything in front of a green screen now.
Yeah.
You could... wonky. It looks wonky still.
Like, I think the difference between Indiana Jones 4 and what's going to happen with Indiana Jones 5 is Steven Spielberg wants to do Indiana Jones 5. He didn't want to do Indiana Jones 4. He said in so many interviews, like... just like he didn't want to do Indiana Jones 2. He was just a hired gun. He didn't want to do it. It was too dark. You know, him and Lucas were kind of going through a divorce at the time, so he wasn't feeling it. You know, everything George threw at him, he's like, I don't like that, but like, you know, I'm just your director for hire. I'll just do whatever you say. You know, and I really enjoy that movie, the second one.
The second one?
Yeah, I love it.
It's decent.
But Indiana Jones 4, he even says in interviews, like, I didn't want to come back to the series. Just let it die. Like, we had a great run with the first three. It's okay. Like, we don't need to do this. But he did it anyway. So like, you can just tell, like, he didn't care.
No.
Like, the only thing, like, he fought Lucas on, because Lucas was like, it's going to be about aliens. Okay, George. It's going to be about this. Okay, George. You know? The only thing he said no to George about was George wanted to be Indiana Jones' daughter. He was just like, no, it's going to be his son. And Lucas is like, okay. That was, like, the only thing that he fought Lucas on. But now I think he actually wants to do it. So it'll probably be a better movie. But Harrison Ford is so old. I mean, he did great in Star Wars. I mean,
he still looked old.
Yeah, he still looked old. I mean, he's like 70. You know, he's old.
Yeah, I don't know what he can do with that part. Yeah,
like, unless they're... I don't think they're going to bring back Shia LaBeouf. Everybody hated it so much, so I don't think they're going to do that. And he's like a crazy person, so...
He is kind of nasty.
Yeah.
Just do it!
Yeah.
Just do it! If you can see me, I'm doing the hand motion there.
Yeah, that's such a great video. It's amazing, but...
It's bananas.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he did it for, like, these film students in England. He went and helped them out with, like, this thing that they were doing, and that's why he did it. It wasn't just some weird thing that he's like, I'm just gonna scream stuff at a camera. Like, no, he did it for... He was helping some students out, but... He's just banana. He has bananas. Like, he has like the weird ponytail, and I mean, he's pretty buff now. Like, even in that video, you could tell he was, you know, he's like, oh, he's been hitting the gym. He's like twice as big now.
Yeah, I don't hate everything he does. I mean,
no, I've actually seen Charlie Countryman.
Oh, well, how was it?
I liked it. You know, it wasn't a bad movie. It wasn't like, you know, the greatest movie I've ever seen or anything, but I watched it from front to back. I wasn't like bored. I wasn't like, God, this sucks. You know, it was fine. He's not a bad actor.
Did you see the Elastic Heart video from Sia?
No.
It's pretty good. He's it's him and the girl from the Chandelier video, kind of doing a interpretive dance thing. Oh, it was very good.
All right.
He does very well. It's very emotive.
Yeah. But I don't know what Indiana Jones 5 could be about. I mean, there's plenty of books and comics that they could base it on. I've actually thought long and hard about, you know, if they were to reboot or make another one, whatever, to Indiana Jones, like, what would be the artifact that he's after? You know, it was the Ark of the Covenant. It was the Holy Grail. It was the Shankara Stones or whatever they were called. There's always something he's after, you know?
Caesar's butt plug. No?
No.
Oh, okay.
Maybe not. It could work. I like the idea of something Roman.
Okay.
But I was always kind of thinking, like, some kind of book, maybe something Norse, you know, because like we've seen the Christian relics twice, you know, and we've seen the jungle twice, two different jungles, you know, the Amazon and the Indian jungles in 2 and 4. So, you know, going up north into the snow, into the Vikings, and so that would be really interesting, but it probably wouldn't have the same aesthetic as, you know, Indy in the desert is so iconic, and then Indy in the jungle is so iconic.
Yeah.
So, but I don't know. I've thought so long and hard, but it might even have to be something based in reality. And Chris Stuckman, he's a YouTuber, he proposed this mine up in Arizona in the Superstition Mountains, which is like a real superstitious mine with tons and tons of gold and stuff in it, and all these like Apache legends and curses and stuff. So like, he pitched that as an idea. I was like, that's not that bad, you know? It's in the desert like it was in the beginning of Indy 3 when he was a kid. He was up in Utah or whatever, so...
Yeah, but what's in the mine?
Gold and ancient curses, I guess.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But, sounds like a movie to me.
Yeah. But Indy 5, I don't know. I honestly think they should have just rebooted it and made it... Because, like, it started off as an idea of 007. You know, because Steven Spielberg, in the 80s, he really wanted to direct a James Bond movie. And Lucas says, I got something better. So it was their version, their American version of James Bond. And what they should have done is after 3, not make 4, where he's an old man in the 50s, but keep it in the 30s, early 40s, maybe. Maybe even go back to the mid-30s when he's a bit younger and recast it, just like James Bond does. Every 5 movies, recast him. You know, and just keep making movies as if the other ones didn't happen. Maybe they did. Maybe you mention them. Maybe you don't. And that's what they should have done.
Yeah, I can see that.
So, I mean,
see, James Bond, I don't think Indiana Jones is really Indiana Jones without Harrison Ford. That's why I don't think the young Indiana Jones ever really appealed to me.
Okay.
I mean, that's just
mostly
my
what
opinion.
I think. That's mostly what I think. Because, yeah, who could play Indiana Jones besides Harrison Ford? Nobody. But I don't want to see Indy as a 70-year-old man, you know, barely making it. So I don't know. Like, maybe they should just...
Indiana Jones and the Curse of the Missing Bedpan. Nurse! Nurse!
Especially because, like, if they're going with the timeline, like, it's going to be the 60s, you know? Like, is it going to have to do with Kennedy's assassination? You know, that might be too early in the 60s, because it's been... This movie will probably come out in 2017, maybe even 2018, which will be 10 years after Crystal Skull, which came out in 2008.
What year was that based in?
1957.
Okay.
Right after Rock and Roll came out. It would be 1967. Kennedy has already been assassinated. They're going to war. Like, is it going to be about the Vietnam War? Like, is it like...
Maybe Indiana Jones goes to Woodstock.
Yeah.
Loose, man.
Maybe he's chilling with some cool 60s musicians, you know.
Free love.
Yeah, dropping some acid, smoking some pot.
No time for love, Dr. Jones. All the time for love.
Yeah. It's like, I don't know, like, I don't think Indy would fit in the 60s.
Well, he would be a curmudgeon. Like,
yeah.
His fucking kids.
Yep. Like, he was already like a grumpy old man in the late 50s.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just imagine him in the 60s with all the free love happening. Like, the world is completely different. So, I don't know. It just seems...
These kids and their weed, cigarettes.
Yeah. It's just going to be a very weird movie. Unless they just, like, not bring in the modern 60s aesthetic too much. Just make it an action-adventure movie set in the desert or the jungle. And it just happens to be in the 60s. Like, you know... the 50s weren't a huge deal, except for the fact that he was a greaser. But other than that, like when they're in the jungle, would you know that that was the 50s?
No, no.
Yeah, except that he's wearing his kid's wearing a leather jacket and keeps combing his hair back. Like, that was the only thing that made it 50s, the second half of the movie.
Mm.
So, I mean, as long as they do something like that, just make it a traditional Indiana Jones movie, it just happens to be in the 60s.
Yeah, you know, I think that's what you need to do. Go back to form.
Yeah.
More practical effects, more practical stunts.
Yep.
And just go back to form. I think that would be fine.
Yeah, I think so too. So, I mean, I'm glad because, you know, we get to see him one more time, you know, together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Spielberg and Ford, but it's almost like, you're just so old, I don't even want to see it. But, I got to put my faith in Spielberg and Ford, especially after seeing Star Wars. He did such a great job. I guess I'm looking forward to it.
Maybe. It'll be good.
Yeah.
I think it'll be fine.
I think it'll be fine, too. It'll probably be better than 4. Let's get into the chunk of our show, Daredevil.
Daredevil.
Oh, God.
So you finished Daredevil?
I finished Daredevil.
I finished Daredevil.
What did you think about season one, real quick?
Season one, way too fucking long.
Okay.
A lot of interesting things happening.
Yep.
Way more violent than I thought it was going to be.
Season one?
Yeah.
Okay.
When Wilson Fisk smashes that Russian's head in the car door.
Yeah, severing the head.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yep. That was... But that, to me, was like the most brutal part of the whole series, or season.
Yeah.
You know, there was like... I haven't watched it since it came out last year.
Mm-hmm.
But watching it, I was like, well, that was pretty brutal. And then the rest of the season, it was like, okay, this is rated R, but it wasn't as rated R as that one scene.
Yeah.
It was like that was the one scene that they really wanted the rated R rating for, was just that one scene. Everything else, like yeah, there was, you know, death and all that stuff. But season two, there's like brain splattering everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
The whole time. So, like, season one, I was like, yeah, it was rated R. There was a few gruesome scenes, but overall, it probably could have been PG-13. If I'm remembering correctly, some people told me, like, no, it was so rated R, but season two is rated fucking R. Hard R.
So many headshots.
Oh my God, so many headshots.
This show probably has the most headshots.
Just, like, it puts ever. RoboCop levels of, you know, the, what are those things called with the blood, the bullet?
Squibs?
Yeah, squibs. So many squibs. Oh, yeah. Oh my God. This is like RoboCop level of just shots to the chest and blood just everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
Headshots, just it's ridiculously rated R. It's pretty
everywhere. Yeah.
But season one, I agree, it was, I think you said it with Jessica Jones, that it doesn't need to be 13 episodes.
Absolutely.
If it only takes 10 episodes, make it 10. If it only takes 5, make it 5.
Right.
And I kind of felt that in season two, because I watched it in like 2 to 3 episode spurts.
Right. Because
I couldn't just sit there and binge
Me
it all
too.
Day. So after the first, like, I think it was like 4 episodes in season two. Spoilers for everybody. I mean, everybody should have watched it, but...
Yeah, get on it.
Yeah. The Punisher was caught and put in jail. He's going to be put on trial and stuff. And I was like, oh, that's... I was thinking, okay, so... And then like right after that, they introduce Elektra. Like the same episode that he was caught and put down, they introduce Elektra. So I was like, okay, the first 4 episodes are going to be Punisher. The next 4 episodes are going to be Elektra. Then probably Wilson Fisk is going to come back for the last part, you know?
And that's kind of what happened.
It's kind of what happened, yeah. But the Punisher was there throughout, you know, his trial was a big part of it. And I think I complained to you and your brother at one of the parties you guys had last year that there wasn't enough lawyering happening in season one.
Right.
It was really just that one episode where that bad guy killed the dude with the bowling ball, which was kind of another gross, gruesome scene. That I just now remembered.
But, yeah, that's true.
Yeah, and but you know, other than that, like the lawyering part had nothing to do with season one. So this one, there was more lawyering going on.
There was a bit more lawyering.
So they kept the Punisher there throughout. He wasn't always the Punisher. You know, he was on trial for like 3 episodes. What's her name? Karen Page.
Karen Page. Yeah.
She always manages to do something else besides just be their assistant.
Yeah. How does she find all this fucking time? Where does she sleep?
Yeah.
How does she end up at every disaster in New York City over this, you know, this time period?
Yeah, and they call it out a few times.
Every single one.
Yeah, and they call it out towards the end. Like you're here at every one.
I would start to think that she was a terrorist.
Yeah, yeah.
Because she's in all of them.
Yep. I would think that she was a big part of it. Yeah. They make her basically a reporter, and that's what she becomes at the end. She works for the bulletin.
Yeah, so she kind of takes up the mantle of
the
reporter character from season one.
Yeah, whose name I forget, but he's actually a huge part of the comics. Joe Pantoliano played him in the movie Daredevil.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, so they killed him last season.
Yeah, Wilson Fisk killed him in the first season.
Yeah, at the end of the first season. But
and so Karen Page kind of takes up his position.
Like, yeah, and she was working with him last season. So she was basically reporting last season, you know
right.
Investigative reporting. And she does it again this season.
And how does she make any money?
Yeah,
how does she get her money?
Because
it's like... Yeah.
Because they don't make any money as lawyers, because they're doing everything for cakes and pies.
Nelson
and
Murdoch aren't making any money.
Yeah.
They're doing pretty much everything pro bono.
Yep.
And, you know, she's just kind of bumming around with this reporter guy.
Yeah. The boss from the Bulletin.
He's not fucking paying her.
Nope.
We never established that at all.
No, at the end, when she says, you know, whatever you say, boss or whatever, and he kind of is like, yeah, you know, you're one of my employees now. So probably next season she will be working.
Maybe that's why she ends up at all these disasters. She doesn't have any place to live, so she just kind of wanders around.
But we did see her apartment this season. We didn't season, yeah. Remember, so, it got shot up and the Punisher saved
right.
her. Yeah. So what I don't like is, like, they established, you know, that her and Matt are going to start a relationship. They go on, like, one date. But then Elektra comes in the mix, so they kind of establish that he's going to be with her. And then she says, like, nope, I'm out. Then he kind of goes back to Karen, and he kind of goes back to Elektra, and it just kind of goes back and forth, and I think you're right with the whole, like, it doesn't need to be 13 episodes.
Absolutely.
It could have been more, it could have been less.
This one
probably could have been a little less. There was a few episodes where we're just like, get on with it.
Especially I think it's like episode 10 and 11,
mm-hmm.
You can feel them stretching the story, like, you feel them stretching it, like,
yep. Maybe,
anything to make a couple more episodes. And it's like, it doesn't have to be this long.
Yeah, no, I totally agree.
So much shit out of there.
Yeah, what did you think about the Punisher?
Punisher...
John Bernthal playing the Punisher.
Right. He was a cool character. My impression of the Punisher from the comics is he's more robotic. He's very linear. He goes straight forward. And, what did you say his name was?
John Bernthal?
John Bernthal from, we've seen
Walking
him in
Dead.
Walking Dead and stuff. He did a lot of emoting. Like, he moved his head a lot. He did a lot of gesticulating.
Yeah.
And I don't feel like that's the Punisher. I think the Punisher's more just a killing machine. He knows exactly what he wants to do. He's going to go for it without emoting.
Right.
If you ever see him, you know, killing people, he's always very stoic about it. You know, he's very dispassionate about it. And this character was very passionate. It works for the storyline. I like the character, but I don't think it was the Punisher.
Okay. See, for me, I've never liked the Punisher.
He was
always just kind of there. I haven't seen the 80s movie with Dolph Lundgren, but I hear it's really not that bad for an 80s Punisher movie with Dolph Lundgren. But
I saw it, but I can't remember anything about
it. I did not like the 2004 Punisher with Thomas Jane.
And
John Travolta.
I didn't like that one either.
I didn't like that one at all. Punisher Warzone was way too... almost silly.
It was
Jigsaw and his face. Like, I didn't really like it.
Grindhouse movie. The thing that
was
so awful about that movie was their accents.
Yeah.
Their fucking New York accents. They were laying it on.
Yeah.
Like salami. It was disgusting. I couldn't stand it. Like, shut the fuck up and just talk like a person.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really, like, cheesy.
It was super cheesy.
Yeah. That first scene where, like, the mob's having, like, their dinner, and he just, like, comes out of nowhere and shoots everybody in the face real quick, and, like, that was cool. But other than that, he, like, crushes the guy's head, and he had, like, super strength. It was really weird. But
it was a very silly movie.
Yeah, but, like, so I've never cared for the Punisher until this show.
Well, what you need to... Have you ever read any of the Garth Ennis?
No, I've never read any comics. Punisher.
I recommend those.
Those are the Warzone ones?
Yeah.
Okay.
Those are the Warzone ones. There was actually a Warzone one in the 90s. I can't remember who wrote it, but John Romita Jr. drew it.
Okay.
And then they had a new iteration with Garth Ennis and the guy who drew Preacher. I can't remember his name. It was very good. That's actually where we got the storyline from the Thomas Jane version of the movie.
Okay.
A lot of that came from the Garth Ennis story. It comes off a lot better on paper, I think.
Okay. Yeah, because that movie was garbage.
Yeah, it wasn't great.
Yeah.
It was executed poorly.
Yeah. But this, John Bernthal, like, he's so brutal. And, like, you're right, like, yeah, normally he's just, like, you know, a machine and stuff like that. But I like what they did. They made me like the Punisher in this show.
Okay.
And that scene where he has Daredevil tied up on the rooftop, and they're just kind of going back and forth about, you know, who's right, who's wrong, what they're doing, and all that stuff, like, and they kind of just start, like, yelling at each other, like, it was great, I loved it, like, I liked the Punisher in the show, and he got gypped at the end, you know, like, he gets out of prison, he gets out, you know, he's out there, and, like, he finds his old general's stash,
weapons,
yeah, and, like, even the vest, before he even spray painted it, it kind of looked like a skull.
Well, you know? During the last half of the season, he looked like a skull. From all the bruises on his face. Bruises under his cheeks and bruises under his eyes.
Yep, yeah.
They made him look like a skull. Yeah. I don't know if that was an artistic choice or not.
It probably was, yeah. But it was weird, because like, it wasn't him. It was, they called him, what was the drug dealer's name that nobody knew at the end? It ended up being
Blacksmith.
Blacksmith, yeah. It ended up being his old general.
Right.
And they were trying to frame the Punisher with the DA. Remember, she was freaking out. She's like, I found this in my little girl's backpack. Right. And it was the picture of his
X-ray.
His X-ray of the skull. I was like, oh, that's an awesome calling card.
Right.
You know, the skull, you know, like, but it wasn't even him, the Punisher doing it, you know, which was kind of a shame because that was a really cool idea.
That would have been a good calling card, but I don't think that character would threaten her daughter.
No.
Which I think was the point of the scene.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're like, wait. That's why...
But the vest looked like the skull. It even had, like, a little... like, the teeth at the bottom.
Right.
And so, he spray paints it and stuff like that. And I knew he was going to come and help Daredevil at the end, you know, fight scene in the last episode. But it was... he just shot two people and says, see you around, right? Yeah, and then just leaves. Like, it's like, oh, that was anticlimactic on his part. Like, he was such a big part of the season that he just kind of got gypped at the end, I thought.
I agree.
But what did you think about Elektra?
Elektra was good. I thought it was a real missed opportunity. Because the original Frank Miller storyline, we have Bullseye.
Oh, well, Elektra, absolutely.
And that, I think that would have been a much more impactful and set you up for a great arch villain, right? A great nemesis. Yeah, but now I think if they bring him up, I've been waiting for Bullseye. I was hoping we would get Bullseye, but we didn't get fucking Bullseye.
No, he's probably going to be the big bad next season.
And that's fine, but I don't think he'll be as impactful without killing Elektra. I mean, they might have him kill Karen Page.
Maybe.
Because I think he kills another one of Matt Murdock's girlfriends.
Yeah, I think he does. That's one of the things, is like Matt Murdock just keeps losing his love interests.
Right. So they'll probably do that.
But you're right, it should have been Bullseye to kill Elektra, but I mean...
And that Japanese hand guy, he might be Nobu. From the comics, I'm not sure.
I'm not sure either. I think there's always some... Big Bad Ninja. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if it was Nobu or not in the comics, but I'm sure there's somebody like him in the comics.
But I don't... I think he was just kind of generic.
Absolutely.
I didn't really care about that villain.
No, I mean,
I was sick of him by the end. I was like, fuck this guy again.
Yeah.
Ugh. And he fought the hand so many times. That's another thing they stretched out, was the fucking... I mean, the fights are great. The choreography's great. But by the end, that's another thing. It's so fucking dark... You can't see them fighting anything. It's just like moving shadows. Like, and this is the last three episodes. Mm-hmm. So much dark fighting.
Yeah.
And I don't know why they made that choice. I guess it's more dramatic, but you can't fucking see anything.
Yeah, I agree. I thought the actress, I don't know her name, who played Elektra was great. I thought she did a great job.
Oh, yeah, you asked me about Elektra.
Yeah. I thought she was great. She was not what I pictured or who I pictured or anything.
No,
But I thought she did a great job with what she was given. You know, she did her best. I thought it was great. The flashbacks of, you know, them meeting in college and hanging out and stuff was nice to see. And then her as a kid, it was kind of cool seeing. And do you remember the Elektra movie?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've watched it, but I don't remember it. So that's kind of a trick question.
Right, she was protecting a 13-year-old girl in that movie and kind of training her. And because you find out there's something called the Treasure. And they think that this 13-year-old girl is the Treasure. And in this show, she ends up basically Elektra being the Treasure. They call her the...
Black Sky.
Mm-hmm. And we find out in season one, we saw a little kid was a Black Sky. Remember, he came in that shipping crate?
Uh-huh.
But so we find out Elektra is a Black Sky. And it's kind of the same. It's probably just, you know, they didn't want to call it the treasure because that's stupid. So Black Sky sounds way cooler.
Right.
But that's basically what it was. And I liked her. I liked her fighting. She kicked a lot of ass. It was kind of inconsistent. Sometimes she could just get thrown off, you know, onto the ground real easy. Other times she was almost impossible to stop. Yeah. And I think a lot of all the characters were like that. Like, the first couple times Daredevil and the Punisher fight, the Punisher just kicks his ass. And then later in the season, Punisher is like a nobody to Daredevil. Like,
right. Yeah.
But so the fights were kind of inconsistent. Overall, Elektra was, I thought she was cool. But like I said, like, you know, she's, they were all about being together. And then she's just like, no, no. And then she leaves. And they come back like, yeah, we should be together. And then no, no.
That's them stretching the storyline. Let's stretch it.
There was a lot happening in this season. A lot was going on. So much stuff. Foggy, he didn't do a whole lot, except for lawyering.
Yeah, he had a bit of an arc. It kind of shows him breaking off from Matt Murdock, going his own way.
Yeah.
And then they bring in the lawyer character.
From Jessica Jones.
Jessica Jones, yeah, to hire him at the end of the season, which Carrie, I really like, Carrie Moss.
Yeah, I like that a lot. I was almost fist-pumping at that moment. Yeah. But they set that up, because his ex-girlfriend from season one came... Or he invited her to the bar, and she even says, you know, last season I put my career at risk to help you out, and I lost my job. A good thing this other place was hiring, and we know that other place was Carrie Ann Moss.
Right.
And they even mentioned Jessica Jones. They say her name.
Yeah.
And then later, when Foggy's in the hospital, she comes to see him and says, like, you know, you made a big splash in the lawyer world representing the Punisher, and that opening statement was really good. He's like, yeah, but I lost the trial. I was like, but it's not your fault that he went crazy on the stand.
Yeah.
And, like, you as a lawyer did a fantastic job, and my employer is going to want to hire you. And then the last episode, we see him at lunch with her, and he makes some kind of reference about how, something about vigilantes and stuff like that, and she has no idea, and she says, you know, try me or whatever, because she knows all about Jessica Jones.
Exactly. So
that was a great moment. That was a fist-pumping moment for me. I was like, yeah, they're bringing it all together. It was great seeing Carrie Ann Moss, you know, the crossovers, and the Night Nurse was only in a few episodes this
Rosario
season.
Rosario Dawson.
Yeah. From what I read before the season came out, like, you know, 6 months ago, that she was going to be a much bigger part of the season, and she really wasn't.
No.
No, she was only there for a little bit. She quits her job, so she's not going to be a Night Nurse from here on out, unless she goes to another hospital, I guess. Yeah, she didn't really do anything.
No, she's just kind of there to get angry at Matt Murdock all over again. Like.
Yeah. Yeah.
And anytime she tries to help him, something gets fucked up, and she blames him, and it's like...
Yeah, but there was a lot happening in the season.
Did we ever find out why that hole was there?
No, we never found out about the hole.
So there's this hole they find, this super big hole.
Yeah, they drop something in it, and like a minute later, Elektra asks, did it hit the bottom? And Murdock says, not yet. And then they get attacked by ninjas.
It was like 30 stories deep or something like that. And they're tracking all the dirt that they're moving from the hole, and it's like... Well, here's this big mystery.
Yeah, then
but
never.
You don't need to know what that's about.
No.
That's the only thing I wanted to know. That's that's half the reason why I finished the series. Because what's the fucking hole?
Yeah.
What's
the
hole? Maybe I missed something. I don't know. But,
no, I don't remember them ever explaining the hole. Stick was a bigger part of this season than he was last season.
That, yeah.
And because last season we find out, like, you're part of this war. And we find out it's him that against the Hand. And the Hand wants... the Black Sky, and with the Black Sky, they can kind of rule the world, and they already make people immortal, and after she dies, they collect her body and put her in the chamber, and we find out that there was a bunch of like teenagers or young adults that they had, they were draining their blood slowly, and using that blood to reanimate people, like Nobu was reanimated,
right.
And... we see this giant chamber thing with all the tubes hooked up to it and stuff, and so we know that's how Elektra's going to come back.
Yeah.
But we never really find out why they're digging a big hole. we know why they're transporting the dirt, because, you know, what else are you going to do with it? They put it in some train cars and ship it away to somewhere, but we never find out why. You know, it's like, why are they digging a really big hole? Like, is that going to be, like, their grave that has dumped, you know, thousands of bodies in? Like, we have no idea.
This is very impractical.
Yeah. So, there's a lot of mystery, but one of my favorite parts is when they go to Wilson Fisk.
That was a great reintroduction of Wilson Fisk.
Yeah, we see, because when the Punisher is on trial, they're going to put him on the stand. And they're trying to make it seem like he's not insane, but major PTSD. But then right when he gets put on trial, the bailiff, whatever, says, you know, he whispers something to him, like, you know, think about it or whatever, you know. He ends up going crazy on the thing. He's like, I am the Punisher. I'm going to kill everybody. Like, so they lose the trial. He goes to jail. What they were trying to do is get him to not, because he's going to jail no matter what.
Right.
They weren't defending him to try to get him out of jail. Just not put him in general population, because everyone in jail is going to want to kill him.
Yeah, you know, that's not how prison works, right?
Yes. But but that's, you know, the way they portray it is if he just goes to jail as a regular inmate, all the other inmates don't like him.
Yeah.
So they're going to want to kill him. So they're what Matt and Foggy, well, really just Foggy, because Matt never shows up except for once
to the trial. Yeah, it was really very annoying.
Yeah. He kept saying, like, no, we need to do this. We need to represent him. But then he never shows up for anything.
Yeah. And that and we kind of follow Foggy, you know, feeling the same annoyance as us. Like you said, we don't spend enough time seeing Matt Murdock be a lawyer.
Yeah,
and exactly. That's a big part of the comics.
Yeah, so like we saw Foggy as a great lawyer. Every time the DA would say something, he would just come back with all kinds of lawyer stuff about how why she can't do that and how they have the right to do all this stuff. Like, he was the better lawyer. Matt was just kind of around for some of it.
Yeah.
He wasn't even around for most of it. He ends up going crazy in the sand, so he does go to general population.
Right.
But instead of just getting checked in, they bring him somewhere else. Some kind of courtyard with, you know, weights and stuff.
Yeah, it's a rec yard.
Yeah, but it's really small. It was like, it wasn't like...
Well, it's an enclosed rec yard.
Yeah, it was. But then you see, like, somebody just, you know, pumping iron, lots of it. It wasn't just, you know, 200 pounds. It was a ton of weight. And
yeah, they had, like, 5 45-pound plates on each side.
Yeah,
it was I didn't do the math, but
yeah. But it ends up being Wilson Fisk. And I was like, yes, that's awesome. And then the next episode, you kind of see a flashback of when he first gets in prison, Wilson Fisk, and kind of how nobody likes him, but he kind of comes to power. And at first he's
in prison, yeah.
Yeah, and the guy who has the power is like, he's like, I know, he goes to Wilson Fisk, he's like, I know you're going to want to take over, but you're not going to. And Wilson Fisk, he's like, I don't want to. But then slowly he realizes, yeah, I kind of want to.
I think I want to, yeah.
But I loved Wilson Fisk in season one. The way he
manipulates everything.
Yeah, you know, just the way he talks.
Oh, yeah.
It makes him seem a little simple. You know, like, his brain's not 100%. You know, just in the way he, his inflections on words and sentences, which I just loved. It was really cool and interesting. So seeing him again, I was like, yes, this is awesome. I love him. Especially against the Punisher, who, like I said, I started to care about through this show. So seeing them together was really cool. And you find out that he wants the Punisher to kill his competition in prison.
Right.
And so the Punisher does, because Wilson Fisk says, hey, this is the guy that was making the drug deal in the park that went sour where your family was. They got caught in the crossfire and they died, which made you the Punisher. This is the guy you're looking for. So Punisher's like, okay, send me to him, but if I ever see you again, I'm coming for you. So he goes and he kills everybody in the cell block, which was super cool.
So he fucking shakes the two guys in the cell.
Yeah.
And then it's kind of a trap. Wilson Fisk, he sent Castle in there to eliminate the competition. He said, that's all. But then Fisk locks him in there with the rest of the cell block.
Yeah.
And he leaves him in there to be eliminated, so... Yep.
But then he doesn't, because the Punisher just slaughters everybody. Yeah.
And then there's a pretty great, like, old boy moment where Frank Castle has to fight...
like, 6 people?
Yeah, close to 10 guys.
Yeah.
And it's a pretty cool back and forth.
In a very enclosed area, a little hallway.
Hallway.
Yeah, super cool. But then Matt Murdock at one point goes to see Wilson Fisk to talk about, you know, why he let the Punisher out. Because he helped get the Punisher out of jail. And then Wilson Fisk just starts slamming Matt against the table and... getting super angry at him because he put him in jail and stuff. And
see, that I thought that was kind of a worthless scene.
Really?
Because Matt goes in there to tell Wilson Fisk what's what.
And then Wilson Fisk tells him what's what.
Wilson Fisk tells him what's what.
Yeah. And it was over.
He goes out there kind of shaking, and nothing was really resolved.
No.
They still hate each other just as much as they did before.
Right.
And
I think the only thing it really established is that, like, yeah, Wilson Fisk, like, he didn't like the fact that he was put in jail by... Nelson and Murdock, you know, but he didn't really have any relationship with Nelson and Murdock.
Right.
Other than the trial, which we never got to see. But now that he's come back to kind of taunt him and try to get something out of him, now he's like, you're just rubbing it in my face that you put me in here. Now, when I do get out, which I'm going to get out, I'm going to put my time in, I'm going to rule prison while I'm here. but I'm not gonna escape. Like, I just let the Punisher escape. I could escape easily. And we see, like, his lawyer constantly coming to him, like, you know, we're protecting your girlfriend with your funds, but to keep her protected, you're running out of funds. Mm-hmm. He's like, I just want to spend my last bit of funds making me king, the kingpin of prison, then I'll finish out my sentence and get out and then reestablish myself once I'm done. But now, that I think what that scene set up was, when I get out, I'm not just going to become a kingpin again. I'm coming after Nelson Murdoch. That guy rubbed it in my face. I already wanted to come after him, but now I really want to come after him. And he's sitting there eating a steak because he's kingpin in prison and saying, he's like, give me everything we have on Murdoch. So it's like, so now we know that he's really mad at Murdoch. That was really all.
We could have just done that scene.
Yeah, yeah.
Give me every file on Matthew Murdoch.
Yeah, we didn't.
We established that the kingpin's got something brewing.
Yeah.
I'm doing a lot of complaining. because it really bugs me that they really stretch it out like that.
Yeah.
But for the most part, I was entertained.
Yeah, I like
the entertaining parts were entertaining. I don't know how you would introduce Bullseye and the Punisher in the same season.
And Elektra.
And Elektra.
Yeah, and keep Wilson Fisk in there. Yeah, it'd be way too much to chew. I mean, they didn't really need the Punisher. They could have made it Bullseye. You know, that was going around shooting people and stuff, but
that's true.
It could have easily been Bullseye, and just instead of, because the Punisher, you know, he's an anti-hero. He's not a bad guy in the comics. That was the one change that they would have had to make if they made it Bullseye instead, was instead of Karen Page constantly saying he's a good guy, and kind of at the end he helps Daredevil, and he's just another vigilante. He just takes it to the extreme. If they made it Bullseye, they probably wouldn't have tried so hard to protect him.
Oh yeah.
And then he would have killed Elektra and not been a good guy at the end. But they could have easily just tweaked a few things and made it Bullseye, and instead of killing those two ninjas on the rooftop, you know, kill Elektra. That would have been a great twist. The season would have been almost better if it hadn't have been the Punisher.
Yeah.
But I'm glad it was the Punisher, because, like I said, this version of the Punisher, I like. I want to see a Punisher show now. I'm not sure how well it would work. He kind of seems like a supporting character. But I liked him enough in this season to now I like the Punisher.
Yeah, they're definitely going to follow up, it seems like.
Mm-hmm.
At the end, he pulls out a hidden disc that says Micro. Was a valuable character in the comics. Yep. That was his kind of tech guy. And
the costumes. I like at the end, Punisher wearing the trench coat, the vest with the skull painted on it, which you only see for 5 seconds, but he looked good.
I think they tweaked the Daredevil costume a bit, too.
From the last episode of last season, because when they show him in the suit for the first time last season, I hated it.
It looked bad.
It looked really, really bad. Really bad, especially the helmet. It just didn't fit. It didn't fit
especially
his face, his lips, and his chin. It just looked stupid in this helmet. And I think they tweaked it a little bit, but then they had the Punisher shoot him in the head, and it cracked the thing.
Mm-hmm.
So he has to get a new helmet.
So you have to change the helmet.
And it looked, at first, like, somebody asked me, like, oh, like, does it look better? Because I was talking to a friend at work, and he had stopped at the episode where he got shot and had to get a new one.
Mm-hmm.
And I had gone forward already after that. I was like, yeah, he gets a new helmet, but it looks the same. It looks just as stupid. But then once he met, I was like, does it look the same? So, you know, I continued watching the series, and I was like, oh, it is different.
I think it looks much better.
It looks much better.
It's a pretty cool costume.
It's so much better now.
Uh-huh.
And Elektra, I like what she wears throughout the season. And then at the end, they get, I forget the character's name, the kind of the simple guy that makes Daredevil's costume.
The costume maker.
Yeah, I forget his name, but well, that's a character I really like.
He's pretty cool.
Yeah, I like him. I like how, like, he's very simple, almost dumb.
I thought he came off dumber in season one.
Yeah.
He's a little more coherent in this season, which was a real letdown for me.
Right.
I liked him being kind of, like, dumb, but making these super cool things.
Yeah, but I like how the whole thing is, he's like, I don't want to do anything illegal anymore. He's like, I'm going to help you out because you're protecting me and my girlfriend Betsy, who we never see. And,
he says Betsy a lot.
Yeah, he does. But I really like that character. He
spends a lot of time at the shop for loving his girlfriend Betsy.
Yeah. But he makes a suit for Elektra, which she looks like Mortal Kombat. Like Molina or somebody from Mortal Kombat. Straight up. She's got the flap coming off the belt in front. You know, she's got the mask. She looks just like, I forget which character in Mortal Kombat, because there's like five women that all look the same.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
But she looks like a character from Mortal Kombat, which looks awesome.
It looks pretty good. I don't know how you would. I always liked the original Elektra costume
right
from the Frank Miller run, but I don't know how that would translate to screen. So yeah. This costume, I thought it was fine.
Yeah, I liked it. That guy makes Daredevil's things.
Billy Club.
Yeah, Billy Club, which is awesome.
It's pretty fucking
cool. It's super
cool.
He can finally swing like Spider-Man. He can use that as nunchucks, which he does, which is super cool.
He does so much Daredevil stuff with that Billy Club.
Oh, yeah.
It was very satisfying.
Yes.
Having him throw out the line, hit someone in the face, and then pull it back in.
Yeah, no, one time. I think
swing like, from stuff. Yeah,
he grapples and swings. It was super awesome. And I like how Elektra's like, where's mine? He's like, well, I only made one.
I didn't know he was coming.
Yeah. He was cool. But overall, I really liked the season. It could have been 10 episodes. They could have cut it down a lot. So, yeah, because there was some stretching, you know. First it was the Punisher, then it was Elektra in this war, then it was, and, you know, the Black Sky and the Hand, and then it was the Blacksmith for a few episodes. And it just, there was so much happening. They could have cut it down.
Yeah, I really liked that the first half was pretty great. Too much stretching in the second half.
Yeah.
And I really liked the ending. I thought it was written really well. We have Karen Page kind of doing a voiceover about being a hero.
Mm-hmm.
And then Matt Murdoff, you know, metaphorically walking off into the sunset with a stick and just establishing that he's kind of being alone, you know, that he's a loner.
Yeah. I liked, like I said, Foggy wasn't a huge part. Like, he had his moments, you know, like I said, he does a lot of lawyering, a lot of legal talk. You know, he gets shot at one point. He's in the hospital for a bit. So when he has his interview with the Thing, all of a sudden he's wearing, like, this super nice suit at the end. And he meets Karen at the Josie's bar. Mm-hmm. And he's like, hey, how, that outstanding bill. She's like, yeah, I'll put it on your tab. He's like, no, I'm going to pay it. She's like, wow.
He's okay. Closing out the tab, yeah.
So they're probably not going to go back. I mean, I'm sure we're going to see it again at the end. When him and Murdoch finally reconcile, they're going to go back to the bar.
Right.
But, yeah, at the end, like, he goes to get his stuff out of the office, and he tells Matt, like, yeah, I paid the electric bill for the rain month. And Matt's like, well, what happens after that? He's like, it's going to be cold and dark.
Yeah. He has some pretty good lines in the show.
Yeah, yeah. And I like that actor as Foggy.
Foggy, uh-huh.
You know, I know him from the Mighty Ducks series. In season one, there was that one episode where him and Karen go out drinking, and he's pretty much just Jack Black.
Oh, yeah.
But
he's being super silly.
Yeah.
Talking about fishmongers.
Yeah, and but I mean, I thought he was good in the season. It's going to be interesting seeing him as a high-class lawyer next season.
Uh-huh.
I mean, if they're even, I'm not sure if I'm going to do Daredevil season 3 before they do the team-up.
A team-up?
Yeah, because their whole, Marvel's initial idea was Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, Iron Fist, team-up would be season 5.
Okay.
But, because Daredevil came out first, just like Iron Man, you know, we can't just not have Daredevil for 4 years, so we did Daredevil season 2, especially since it did so well. And we got a, did you stay around for the preview for Luke Cage?
No.
No, there was a little preview. It wasn't really a preview, just a scene. It's Luke Cage. He's getting shot at, and he's just like, I'm sick and tired of having to buy new clothes.
Yeah.
You know, because he's unstuck, he can't be shot and stuff. But it looks very, what's the term? Blaxploitation.
Okay.
Like, very 70s, like, Shaft, kind of. Like, the way the logo for Luke Cage looks very Shaft and very 70s. It looks fun.
I hope it's fun. That's one issue I have with these series, is they're so heavy.
Yeah.
I think they're missing a lot of the fun that we have in the Marvel movies.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. It almost seems like they're not connected at all.
Right. It's like two completely different universes.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand this is kind of the Marvel Knights universe in a way, which is obviously darker.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it just doesn't have the fun tone that the Avengers and Captain America movies have.
Right.
And I think that's something they need to improve on.
I think that's what people like, is that we get the fun in the movies with those characters, and that's well and great, because everyone complains, like, there's no hope and joy in Superman in this new Batman v Superman movie. Like, it just looks so dour and dark. And But on the TV aspect, it's like yeah, we have so much bright fun with the Marvel movies. We kind of like the dark, dour shows.
Okay.
You know, I mean, but you're right. If they ever try to congeal them together, is going to be like, whoa, that doesn't work. Like, why is Daredevil so light and fun, you know?
I don't need him to, you know, go but, around hugging people.
Well, I know, but I'm saying, like, if you take this Daredevil and put him into the next Avengers movie, yeah, it might not work because it's so different.
You might be able to incorporate him, but he'll have to be like a Batman character where he's just, like...
Yeah, brooding, most definitely. Like, yeah.
Had so many girlfriends get killed. It's brutal being me.
Yeah. I can't see anything. I actually thought, like, because after Punisher shoots him in the head, he kind of loses his ability to hear. There's that scene where he's at home and he can't hear anything. He's screaming and we can't hear anything either. I was like, wow, that'd be interesting to play throughout the series where he's, you know, almost like Spider-Man losing his powers in Spider-Man 2.
Spider-Man 2, yeah.
Like, you know, like in times where he's fighting, all of a sudden he can't hear anything. He can't see anything, you know, because of that. He just gets pummeled and stuff. But they really only show it that one time.
Yeah, he kinda gets over it. It never really paid off.
No, it didn't. He just kind of gets over it. Okay, overall, I liked the season. It was super brutal. Like we said, like, blood everywhere. The Punisher slaughters people like crazy. There's so much death.
Yeah, there's a lot.
Yeah, it's crazy. But yeah, I liked it. I thought it was a good season. I might like it better than season one.
I definitely like it better than season
one. Yeah, but I haven't gone back to season one in a year now, so right. I don't remember every little thing about it. But yeah, I definitely enjoyed it. It was a good season. I'm interested to see if they do a Daredevil season 3 before they team up, because we have Luke Cage coming out, and then Iron Fist, and then a team up. So in that time, they might do a season 3, because this is probably their biggest property, because Jessica Jones was good, but nobody cares.
Right.
You know, it's Jessica Jones. Nobody cares about Jessica Jones, so...
Yeah, it seems to be pretty popular. I don't, I don't run that place, but... Netflix, but... I don't know, yeah. I think they set it up for a third season, I think.
Yeah, exactly. Like, there probably should be a Daredevil season 3 before the team-up.
Yeah, because they kind of have an ambiguous ending with Elektra and...
Yep. Yeah, she's definitely coming back. She'll be alive. But yeah, it was good. I recommend it to anybody who wants to watch a cool Daredevil season and doesn't mind... tons of blood and guts and brains everywhere, because there's a lot of it.
You know, it's very successful. I nitpick a lot, but I can't say I wasn't entertained. I think it was a good season. The acting was great. I think it's one of the best acted shows. Like,
yeah, it's great.
That I can get into.
But yeah, do you recommend it?
Absolutely.
Yeah, me too. It was good. But all right, so yeah, we both recommend that. Let's move into our. Our fan casting. We did a gender bender because, like I said at the top of the show, the idea of changing the Ghostbusters to all women is super intriguing to me. It's a great idea. I think it's really great. For some reason, just really hits a spot with me. It's like, well, that's a great idea. I thought it'd be a good idea that we did our own gender bending fan cast. And I don't know which series or movie or whatever that you chose to gender bend. And you don't know what I chose.
Nope.
So this is a complete surprise for both of us.
Yes, it is.
And I went through a ton of changes.
Okay.
A ton of changes. I went through so many actresses. It was ridiculous because I chose the Avengers.
Oh, nice.
Yes, and I chose the first Avengers movie. So I did the main guys that are in the Battle of New York. So I didn't do Nick Fury. I didn't do Maria Hill.
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't do Coulson. I just did...
Such as Thor, Captain America...
The Hulk, Hawkeye, and Black Widow.
Black Widow.
And Loki, because he was there in the battle.
Right.
So those are the ones that I did. With Captain America, I was like, okay, this is the only one that I absolutely have to cast an American actress. Because there are a lot of British and Australian actresses out there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so hard. I went through so many lists of actresses. I was looking at my movie collection, like, oh, who was in that movie? And who was in this one? And... oh my god, it was so hard. Before I get into it, what did you choose to fan cast?
The movie I chose to fan cast was Bloodsport.
Bloodsport, okay.
Corny action movie from 1988. Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Yeah, a Van Damme movie, okay.
Mm-hmm.
And how many characters did you end up gender bending?
Just about as many as you. I got about 7.
Okay.
And then a couple also rans, a couple honorable mentions, maybe.
Okay. I'll go first.
Okay.
I did, like I said, the Avengers. I'll go in an order.
In an order. That's a good way to go.
Yeah. Let's do Loki first. I did Loki, and I chose Eva Green.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you might remember her from A Dame to Kill For, the Sin City sequel, 300 A Rise to an Empire, the 300 sequel. Mm-hmm. She was in Casino Royale. She was in a really terrible TV show called Camelot.
Never saw that.
Yeah, it was really, really bad.
But I know Ava Green.
Yeah, yeah, Ava Green. She was in Dark Shadows. She's in all kinds of stuff. She gets around. She was in The Golden Compass, which was a terrible movie, with, what's his name? Daniel Craig, who plays Bond. So they were in two movies together. I'm not sure if they ever shared a scene in that movie, but she's got the right look. She is great at playing a villain and stuff like that, so I thought she would be a great Loki.
I agree.
Yeah. For the Hulk, this was a really hard one.
So is it going to be She-Hulk?
It's not going to be the character of She-Hulk.
Okay. Because
the character of She-Hulk is her own character. She's the She-Hulk all the time. You know, she is her in her Hulk state, but, you know, is intelligent the whole time.
Right.
This is going to be a female version of the Hulk.
Gotcha.
So.
Just out of control.
Right.
Berserker.
Yes. And I cast... I didn't really cast the Hulk. I casted Bruce Banner.
Okay.
You know, the scientist part.
Right.
Because, you know, in the movie, he would just be CGI. And I cast Nikki Reed. And you probably don't have any idea who she is. But she was in the Twilight movies.
Then definitely not.
Right. And my girlfriend and I watched all four of the movies just last year. She was one of the vampires in the family already. So she does a good job of that. And she's actually like a writer in Hollywood and stuff like that. So.
Oh, okay.
And she just has this look. I actually have a picture. So you know, she's got the dark hair in the show. I think she's blonde, but or in the Twilights, but she's got the right look. She's like 5'4", so she's not super tall. Because I looked at a lot of actresses, and they were like 5'8", 5'10", and I was basing this off of who I cast as Thor, who was only 5'7". I was like, well, Thor can't be like the shortest one. You know, so I tried to look for some shorter actresses to play
movie
everybody
magic,
else.
Man. It doesn't matter how tall they are.
Well, yeah, you're right, but I mean, that's what I was basing this off of. But,
okay.
So Nikki Reed plays the Hulk and Bruce Banner.
Well, she looks the part.
Yeah.
She looks like, throw some glasses on her, she could be
a scientist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A gamma radiation nerd.
Yep. All right, well then we did Black Widow. This is the only male, so I'll get this one out of the way. Because it was really the only woman up in the Avengers, so this would be the only male in my Avengers.
Okay.
And I went with Anton Yelchin, who was an actual Russian actor. You might remember him in Star Trek and Star Trek Into Darkness as Chekhov. In the first Star Trek, he couldn't speak to the computer because his accent was so thick.
Yeah. No, I don't remember that guy.
This guy right here, Anton Yelchin.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and he's been acting since he was a kid. He was in Along Came a Spider and all kinds of stuff.
Really? He came off so nerdy in Star Trek.
Well, yeah, but I mean, he's an actual good actor, because like I said, he's been doing it since he was kid, so, and he's actually Russian, you know, so he could play the Russian spy.
So you think
he
can go a little dark and...
Yeah, and he can play the Russian spy, turned good guy. So that's why I went with Anton Yelchin.
I feel like Black Widow is like a female 007, right?
Lots of sex
appeal and style.
Yeah.
I don't see this guy seducing a lot of women to get their passcodes or anything like that.
I don't know. I think he could pull it off.
All right.
His counterpart in the Avengers movie, Hawkeye.
Hawkeye.
And this is one I had a lot of trouble with. Because it could be played by anybody.
Right.
You know, pretty much anybody could just get a bow and arrow and get some physical training to be, you know, someone who could kick ass. But I ended up going with...
Jennifer Lawrence.
No.
Nope.
No. I ended up going with Hayden... Panettiere, I think is how you say her name. She was in Heroes. This is actually kind of a bad picture to recognize her from. But
yeah,
she was like,
okay,
the main
yeah.
short girl in Heroes. She was also in Scream 4. But she's a good actress, and she's really short, it turns out. I wasn't trying
you
to cast
a lot based on height.
Yeah,
like.
Yeah.
You but, really go deep into their stats.
Yeah, and age. I cast a little bit young. You know.
Do you cast by GPA?
No, not by GPA.
Okay.
That would go a little too far into it. But yeah, I've seen her in, you know, Heroes and stuff like that. So she's good. So I cast her as Hawkeye. Thor. This is who I based everyone's height on. I cast...
This is your standard?
Yeah. I cast Ronda Rousey.
Nice.
Who is a UFC fighter.
Mm-hmm.
She was the champion. Just recently she lost her belt sometime last year. She's actually been in some movies. She was in... one of the Fast and Furious movies.
She was in...
Or no, she was in...
the Expendables. Furious 7. She was in the Expendables.
Yeah, so she's been in movies before. She's got the right look. She's got the physicality for sure.
Absolutely.
But she's only 5'7". And like I said, like the little girl from The Lost World, Jurassic Park, in the beginning,
mm-hmm.
who got attacked by the compies, she's still an actress, but she's 5'10".
Wow.
Yeah, I was like, wow. You know, like I can't have everybody taller than Thor. So, because I wanted to cast her as one of the other characters, but...
Yeah, put a hammer in her hand and a cape on her back. She looked badass.
Yeah, I went with Ronda Rousey because she's definitely got the physicality. She's definitely got the bulk and everything. So, that's why I went with her for Thor. Yeah, she's not an actress. She's a fighter, you know. Mm-hmm. But she's been in some movies, so she's interested in it, at least. And she's actually on one of the covers of the Sports Illustrated right now. Swimsuit Justice edition. Thor? No.
Oh, swimsuit edition.
Yeah. So, I mean, she's obviously an attractive woman and everything.
I agree.
Yeah. And so I think, you know, just put her through some voice coaching for some kind of English or Norse accent or something like Thor has. And, you know, she probably won't be able to pull it off, but it'll be enjoyable nonetheless. But then I went with Captain America. This one was kind of hard to do because, like I said, this is the only one that I absolutely had to be an American actress.
Okay.
You know, and... There's so many British and Australian actresses that I love, but I ended up going with Katie Sackhoff.
Nice.
Like we mentioned earlier.
Fucking perfect.
Yeah, she's a good actress. She's got the physicality. She's actually, you know, quite a big person. She is 5'6", so she's almost as tall as Thor.
Nice.
Even in Thor, the Avengers movie, Captain America is almost as big as Thor.
Right.
Steve, what's his name?
Chris Evans,
you know, he bulks up.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so he's almost as big as Chris Hemsworth. So casting somebody who's could have played Thor, Katie Sackhoff, as Captain America, I thought was a good choice for me.
Yeah. I've seen her in Battlestar Galactica right. kicking ass.
Yeah, I've never seen it, but I have seen one episode. I watched it at my dad's house. And
okay.
So.
Yeah, you get to see her throw some punches. I think that's a great choice.
Yeah. Phenomenal, and she's got the right look. She's pretty. I like her look, and she's got the physicality. And last but not least, Iron Man, the Iron Maiden, if you will. This was the hardest because in the movies he's the oldest actor of the bunch, Robert Downey Jr. You know, mm-hmm. you need somebody who is charismatic, can be funny, can be serious, can play the philanthropist, the believable inventor and stuff, and I went through so many choices. I ended up going with Anna Kendrick. Anna Kendrick, she is in... she was actually in the Twilight movies as well, ironically.
Right.
But she was in the Pitch Perfect movies.
Mm-hmm.
And I never saw the Pitch Perfect movies. They don't really interest me. But
me neither.
I did see the Twilight movies, like I said, and she just kind of plays her friend from school, not a huge part. But I ended up going online and looking up all kinds of stuff that she does... Like, just comedic things that she's done. She did, like, a spoof on Indiana Jones.
Oh, yeah.
Which was really great. It's her getting the Grail and talking to the Knight Templar, and it's really funny. Then there's this little skit where she is, like, working from home, and she just has this phone, and she's just wasting time watering her plants and doing these silly things. And she was really funny, and she's super charismatic, and she's great to look at.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's the face that I want to see behind the mask. I like how in the Iron Man movies
they... You want to see her face behind a mask?
Well, no. What I'm saying is, like, in the movies, like, you know, when Iron Man is wearing his mask, you get to see Robert Downey Jr.'s face.
Yeah, you have the HUD over.
Yeah, yeah, and face, what he's seeing and stuff. Okay. And so that's the kind of face that I want to see doing that.
Okay.
So that's why I went with Anna Kendrick, is because she is funny and charismatic, and I can see her, you know, behind that mask. But yeah, that's my fan casting for the Genderbender of the Avengers.
Cool, man.
All right, so what do you got for us?
Okay, so I chose Bloodsport. Jean-Claude Van Damme's, I think it's a canon film from 1988.
Okay, canon,
yeah. Have you seen this?
I have not.
Unfucking believable.
I'm not a really big Jean-Claude Van Damme fan.
This is one of the best worst movies ever made.
All right, I'll definitely watch it then.
It's super corny, some of the worst dialogue you'll ever have the displeasure to hear. The fight scenes are really antiquated, like... shot really poorly. You can see these guys pulling punches. You can see them throwing fake punches 2 feet away from other people's faces.
Okay.
You have a lot of the quick cut fighting. You can't really tell what's going on. There's a lot of camera trickery to make things look really great. It's a fun movie. It's super classic 80s garbage.
Right.
And I love it.
Sweet.
I don't know how my height ratios are going to work out, so I think you'll have to check my work on that.
Okay.
I'll
be the height checker.
Just to make sure everything pans out. So I'm going to go from, like, least important characters to, I think, most important characters.
All right.
Yeah, and I really like this idea of doing the gender bending.
Yeah, I think it's great.
I think mixed martial arts is super huge right now. Female mixed martial arts has really gotten a super huge boost over the last year. Like,
oh, yeah, especially because of Ronda Rousey.
Because of Ronda Rousey. Yeah. And it's just blown up.
Yeah, it really has.
And so that was really the first thing that came to my mind when... when you mentioned doing a gender bender fan casting, I thought, you know, mixed martial arts and a martial arts movie.
Cool.
We had The Fighter a couple years ago.
Yep.
What am I thinking of? The one with Tom Hardy.
Warriors.
Warriors, right?
Or Warrior.
Warrior. Maybe see something like that.
Right, okay.
With ladies.
Right,
that's not exactly what Bloodsport is.
Okay.
But I think in that vein, right off the bat, I'm going to say this. I made this fan cast a couple days ago.
Okay.
And it took me a long time and a lot of work because this is the first fan cast I've ever done.
Mm.
And I didn't realize how much work goes into it. And then listening to How Did This Get Made yesterday, the podcast How Did This Get Made.
Oh, okay, yeah.
They did a podcast on Bloodsport.
Nice.
Which I didn't see coming. And then Paul Scheer did some research. It turns out they're actually doing a gender bender blood sport movie. And a lot of the people they mentioned they want to see in that movie are on my list.
Nice.
So just full disclosure, I came up with my list before that happened.
Okay.
So I don't want anyone who listens to this and How Did This Get Made to
be like, oh, you just caught
point
them.
Fingers. No, I didn't.
Okay.
But I really I wanted to put it out there, so...
Right, you actually did put the effort in.
I did put the effort
in.
But I was disappointed because, like, it took me so long to do this fucking list. And then they just kind of whipped it out like that. Oh, yeah, she should be in this part. She should be in that part. I was like, it took me 45 minutes to figure out she should be that part. Like,
right.
And they were just kind of spitballing.
Right.
And I guess that's the difference between me and Paul Scheer.
What? Great minds think alike, I guess.
Oh, I think he thinks a little better than I do. But that's all right, so... just to get that out there. So the first person I chose to cast, he was kind of the escort, the liaison. Oh, just to let you know what the movie's about.
Okay.
They have a, I don't know if it's yearly or every couple years, but they have a huge martial arts tournament in like Bangkok or Singapore or something like that.
Okay.
And they call it the Kumite.
Kumite.
And it's the ultimate warriors come together from all over the world to see who's the best fighter.
Right.
Right? And it's a no-holds-barred competition. Anything goes.
Nice.
People die sometimes in this competition. And I guess it's just for honor. I don't remember them talking about a purse or anything like that. Why anyone would do this fight.
Right.
I guess just to prove you're the best. I think that was a big thing in the 80s. Just
right.
Like, who's, you know...
who's the best?
American competition, you know?
Yeah.
Jean-Claude Van Damme plays I don't know if he's French-Canadian or French, a French-Canadian-American.
Okay.
So he's representing America going to the Kumite, but, you know, he has his thick, thick accents, you know?
Right.
And so that's just to let you know what the movie's about. So the Kumite, right? So we have the escort who's taking them, you know, showing them around the city, showing them how to get to the Kumite. And was played by Ken Siu. I liked his style in the movie. He was very charismatic, very funny.
Okay.
The character's name was Victor Lin. The person I wanted to see take the place of him is Ellen Page. I think.
Okay, I almost cast her as the Hulk.
Oh, did you?
Yeah,
that
almost.
That would have been fucking awesome.
Yeah, I almost did.
Tiny little Ellen Page turns into the Hulk.
Right, that's why. Yeah.
But she matches the character, she's very quirky. I think she can do comedy very well,
mm-hmm.
And she's kind of skittish and mousy, just like the character.
Okay, sweet.
We've seen her in stuff like Days of Future Past, Juno, and Super.
Yep.
And if you've ever seen Super, you know she can do comedy. So. Mm-hmm. So that's that character. Another character was the father of Jean-Claude Van Damme's best friend in the film.
Okay.
his best friend ends up dying in the Kumite, or just dying. So the father takes Jean-Claude Van Damme under his wing, teaches him his martial art, and then he represents this style in the Kumite.
Okay.
That guy is Senzo Tanaka. He was played by Roy Chow. And the woman I wanted to see take the place of this character was Michelle Yao, I think it was.
Michelle Yao from Crouching Tiger?
From Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. Okay. She can play the older, wiser...
Oh, yeah. Was she in the sequel that just came out on Netflix?
I believe she is,
okay,
yeah.
Okay, I haven't watched it yet, but yeah.
And I think she would play a good mentor. I think she's perfect. I mean, it doesn't have to be karate. It can be kung fu.
Right.
And, yeah, that's just all I thought about that. I think she'd be perfect.
Awesome.
So then we have the villain of the film, which is Chong Li. And Chong Li actually... Jean-Claude Van Damme makes a friend, right? Another American representing America in the Kumite. And Chong Li actually stomps this guy almost to death.
Nice.
So he's a very bad villain. He's very brutal. So he's played by Bolo Young. And he's in a lot of kung fu stuff. If you've seen Bloodsport, you've seen him in a couple other things. He's just a super buff... I want to see he's Japanese, but I don't think he's Japanese. I think he's something else.
Okay.
But he's very effective in this movie. Plays a very good bad guy. And the person I want to see take Bolo Young's place is Gina Carano.
Nice.
The mixed martial artist. And we know she can play a badass. We've seen her in The Fast and Furious 6. We've seen her in Haywire. And she played the villain. One of the villains in Deadpool.
Yes, she did. We just saw her recently.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's what made me think of her being the villain in this.
Right.
We saw her be the villain in Deadpool. I think she could do a great job being Chong Li. I think she has the charisma to pull it off.
All right.
Yeah,
I like her as an actress. She's not the greatest actress, but she's got the right.
And that's kind of the point of this movie. Is no one's a great actor in this movie. So I can cast whoever I want in it.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't need it to be a great movie.
That's...
You know what I need? Fucking fights.
Yeah.
I need some good fights. I need shitty dialogue and good fights. So then we move to the romance. The romantic interest in the movie.
All right.
Her name is Janice Kent, the character, and she was played by... Leah Aries?
Okay, that's probably how I would pronounce it too, yeah.
She was very beautiful in the film. She had this great 80s hair, you know. And so I'm going to, you know, do a gender swap.
Right, so she'll be the male.
Yeah, so it'll be a male love interest.
Right.
And I actually cast Channing Tatum.
Oh, okay.
So the character's a reporter, right? And she's trying to get the scoop on the Kumite.
Ah.
So I figured... Channing Tatum can be this dashing reporter.
Right.
Trying to get the scoop on the Kumite. He becomes a love interest of the main character, who's a female fighter.
Okay.
So we can actually see a gender swap where she might have to protect him in some situation. There's a bar scene in Bloodsport where she's kind of getting harassed by these Saudi Arabian fighters that are going to the Kumite. And Jean-Claude Van Damme kind of steps in and pulls her away from that situation. So maybe Channing Tatum's being bullied by someone or something, and then our main character will go in and just kick some ass.
All right, nice.
And he could be the damsel in distress. I don't know. What's the man version of a damsel?
I don't know.
Me neither. But I think that would be an interesting role.
Nice.
The next one we have is Jay Jackson, who plays the friend character of Jean-Claude Van Damme, and is played by Donald Gibb. You'll remember Donald Gibb from Revenge of the Nerd movies.
Okay.
He plays Ogre.
Okay.
Nerds, the big bully guy. And he's pretty good in this movie, pretty comedic. He's not a great fighter by any means.
Okay.
He can't move around a lot, so he just plays like a crusher. He just like hits guys in the head and they fall down, and that's what he does. So who I wanted to see take the place of that character is Melissa McCarthy.
Ah, All right.
Yeah, and we've seen her move around. You see her in films like Bridesmaids. She plays like a undercover CIA operative, kind of rough and tumble.
Right.
We've seen her in Heat.
Right.
She plays an undercover cop who can move around and kick ass.
Yep.
And I think she would be good as a bruiser in the Kumite. Nice. She's got the comic relief.
Right.
Because that's what she does. She's the comic relief. But
yeah.
We also know she can move around and kick some ass.
Yeah, spy.
So why not? Yeah, spy. Yeah.
Yep. And upcoming Ghostbusters.
Exactly.
Yeah, which this is in honor of.
The last character we have is the Frank Dux character played by Jean-Claude Van Damme in Bloodsport. And this goes back to your list. I would cast Ronda Rousey.
Nice.
Yes.
Hell yeah.
We've seen her in action movies like Furious 7 and Expendables 3.
Yeah.
Just kicking ass. I think she's a poor enough actor that she could really step up to the plate and take the mantle from Jean-Claude Van Damme. I think it'd just be fun.
Would you have her go through voice training like I would for a cheesy accent?
To make her have a French accent?
Because it would just be like the worst accent ever.
No, I just want her deadpan, like, shitty takes to be in the film. Just her? Just have her be her.
Okay.
Yeah. If you've ever seen her dialogue from Expendables 3, it's not great. No. Her lines are delivered like a lead weight.
Yeah.
Just thud.
Yep.
So some honorable mentions in, like I said, it's a big mixed martial arts tournament, so we're going to see lots of other people,
right,
you know, fighting. In the movie, they have montages, you know, of other fighters, you know, going through the ranks, taking other people down, stuff like that. So other people I might want to see in there is, there's plenty of, like, kung fu actresses that you can totally throw in there.
Oh, yeah.
Just to honor them, just to have a good cameo. One that popped to the top of my head was Jija Yanin from Chocolate.
Okay.
Did you ever see Chocolate?
I did not.
It's like a Jackie Chan style kung fu stunt movie. It's fucking fantastic.
All right.
There's this the entire ending sequence happens in like the side of a building, and they're fighting from fire escape to fire escape. They're knocking air conditioners off the wall. They're falling to the ground. They're falling off, you know, fire escapes. It's really great.
Nice.
I think it would be good to see her, you know, do some kung fu.
Right.
I'd like to see Gwendolyn Christie. Do you know who that is? She plays Brienne of Tarth.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I'm going to say the name sounds so familiar, but yeah.
Captain Phasma in The Force Awakens.
Yep.
I think it'd be good to have a huge woman in there just fucking shit up.
Yep.
You know, and she doesn't have to be a great fighter. We can use camera work just like they did in Bloodsport. But I think she'd be a good addition.
Yeah.
I like her physicality in Game of Thrones.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Yeah, I almost cast her as Thor, but...
Oh, nice. Yeah. That's a good pick.
Yep. Yeah,
so, why not throw her in something physical? Then there's a younger woman from Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, which is Xia Zhang, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
She was great in that. She was really spunky and mean in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. I think that'll go good with the Kumite.
Right.
The
Kumite.
Kumite. There's a whole song. Kumite. 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 So bad. This woman's only been in one movie. It's Olga Kirkulina. And she's a Russian fitness model. She was in Kick-Ass 2.
Okay.
She played Mother Russia, the big buff.
I've not watched it yet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, she plays this big buff bruiser. She throws cars in the movie. Like,
nice.
Yeah. I think she'd be a good woman in the Kumite, just representing Russia.
Right.
And then there's a boss character in Bloodsport. You know, I can't remember his arc or anything like that. He just kind of run in the Kumite, I think. He's a heavy hitter. He's a shot caller.
Okay.
And I think someone who could represent that character well would be Sigourney Weaver.
Oh, nice.
I mean, she's 67 now.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah. And she looks great.
Yeah.
She looks really great.
Yeah.
So I think throw her into like a sharp suit and have her calling some shots and like...
Yeah,
I like running the Kumite. I think she's got the meanness to run this kind of blood sport.
Yeah.
And I think it would go well to see that character expounded on.
Right.
That's my blood sport.
Genderbender fan.
Genderbender blood sport. Yeah.
Nice. That's awesome. It's hard, huh? Fan casting.
It's it's hard.
Yeah. Going through all the actors and actresses, seeing like, oh, that would be good, but no, I didn't like him in that movie. Maybe he's not the right pick. And yeah, you just go through so many choices. And like I've always said, like, I try not to just go straight to the A-list, you know, for everybody. Like oh, Jennifer Lawrence could be the lead actress and everything. And,
yeah,
you know, and The Rock and Robert Downey Jr. and like all these people. Like, I try not to do the same people over and over again.
Right. I think that'll be more challenging if I get into this a little more.
Right. Yeah. To not use the same people again and again.
Right. I wasn't really trying to avoid A-list actors, obviously.
Right.
I was just going for what I thought would be the most fun.
Let's get into the board game news.
Board game news.
Not a whole lot going on?
Fucking nothing. The only thing I really saw is Cool Mini or Not and IDW are both releasing Godfather games.
Okay.
Based on the...
The movies?
Yeah, the Mario Puzo stories and the movies.
Right.
I have no idea what the mechanics are going to be. The IDW one looks like an area control game.
Okay.
But that's pretty much all I saw that really interested in me. But I'll keep you posted on that. Not much. All
right. Yeah, well, not a whole lot of movie news going on, so...
Yeah, slow week.
Yeah, very slow week.
Slow week.
Yeah. But you have a board game to talk about today.
I do have a board game to talk about today.
All right, what do you got for us today?
Today I'm going to talk about Formula D.
Ooh, nice. I've actually played that one.
You've played Formula D.
Excellent. A long time ago, but yes.
So I think I mentioned before, this is the first board game I've ever bought.
Right.
And it was a great investment. It's a race car game.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a race car game based on dice. So it's like Formula One, except Formula D. You're rolling a die. Right?
Right.
And what it is you have a race car track, and it's incrementally segmented, so it's got spaces.
Right.
And your race car is going to move a number of spaces depending on what you roll on your die. Right?
Right.
Your dies are determine how fast you're going. So you're going to have a player board. That has a little stick shift on it. The player boards are great. They're one of the coolest components I've ever seen in a board game. You get your own little stick shift, and you're shifting up to second gear and third gear. So whichever gear you're in determines which dice you're going to roll. And the higher the gear, the higher the numbers are going to be on the dice.
Right.
So, for instance, your first gear is going to be a four-sided die, but it only... goes 1 to 3. So you're going to have multiple numbers on the same die.
Okay.
Your second gear is going to be a 6-sided die, but it only goes 1 to 4, I believe.
Okay.
Or 2 to 4, excuse me, 2 to 4. So depending on what you roll, you're either going to move 2 spaces or 4 spaces, right, and so on. The dice get higher, and that kind of represents how fast your car is moving in that gear. Trying to build up speed and get the higher dice. But the trick comes in the turns. There's going to be turns on the track, and the turns are bordered out, and you have to stop a designated number of times inside the turn before you can move on, or you'll take penalties.
Right.
You'll want your car to... This prevents you from going way too fast. So you can't go into fourth gear, you know, if you're only 2 spaces outside of a turn. You're going to overshoot it. If you overshoot it, your car is going to take damage, and eventually you won't be able to race anymore.
Right.
So the strategy comes in that. The strategy, there's only 3 lanes in any track, so some strategy comes into blocking, making people slow down and if you're in front of them, having them go outside and maybe make a turn they didn't want to. And it's just a fun racing game. What else can I say about it? That's pretty much the gameplay.
Right. Yeah, I remember the having to slow down for turns.
Right.
And so they, you know, go to a lower dice so you don't overshoot the turn and crash. And
that's it forces you into some really intense decisions because you don't want to slow down too much.
Right.
But you don't want to overshoot the turn.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever get a 20-sided die? Does that ever come to play?
Yeah, there's actually... That's... I think there's 5 gears.
Okay.
So that'll be 4th gear. And 6th gear is a 30-sided die.
Wow.
Yeah. But like I said, if you're rolling that and you got a turn coming up, you're going to overshoot your turn and blow your car up. So you got to be careful how fast you're going. This is a great introductory game. It's easy to learn, easy to teach. I think little kids can play this game.
Right.
They have two different difficulties. You have, like I said, your car can take damage, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you have a more difficult level where your engine's going to be taking damage, or your tires will be taking damage, or your gearbox will be taking damage. Or you can flip that over to the beginner side where you just have a certain amount of damage points.
Oh, if
you run all those down, then your car's out of the race.
Right, so instead of different things taking different damages, it'd just be one.
That's kind of where the intricacies come into the game, is each part taking damage for different things.
Right.
So you can just flip it over and just have one base damage.
Right, It makes it a little simpler for beginners.
Yeah, it makes it very simple.
Yeah, it's cool that they incorporated that into the game.
Yeah.
Making it, you know, different for a different level of player.
That's always good, yeah.
Yeah.
To have an introductory thing. I've shown my mother this game, my father this game. They both love it.
Nice.
They're not super into board games, so that kind of shows you how easy it is to get to.
Right.
It's easy to learn, easy to teach, and it's fun. It's fun as hell. The more people you have playing it, the better it is. We've had 8-player games at the board game shop. It gets very intense because, like I said, you have blocking. There's a lot of maneuvering that you can do. And once you have people gunning for you, it gets really intense.
Nice.
That's basically it. You have different tracks that you can buy, so you're not always stuck to the same tracks that the game comes with. The game comes with 2 tracks.
Okay.
And it actually comes with an alternate version where you can do street racing.
Oh, okay.
And then your street racing characters, each one has their own special power.
Ah, nice.
Yeah, so one guy, he throws his radio out of the car, for instance, and if you're next to him, you have to roll to see if you take damage.
Right, okay. Oh, that's cool. That's
so little things like that.
Yeah. Almost like Mario Kart.
In a way. Stuff. Yeah, not quite as, you're not going to have the volume of like turtle shells and banana peels that you have in Mario Kart.
Right.
But there's a little bit of competition like that. There's a couple of mods that people have done in Board Game Geek where you can turn it into like a Car Wars kind of race.
Yeah, I've actually played Formula D, but it was like most of my gaming like over 10 years ago now.
Oof.
So it's been a long time.
Yeah, this game has been around for a while. It used to be Formula Di, D-I, I believe is a French game.
Okay.
So this is just a modern update of that. So I think this game has stood the test of time. And that shows what a good game it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember playing it at the board game shop and having to slow down to roll the lower dice for the turns and everything, and switching lanes to get around people and stuff. And yeah, it was fun. I liked it. I haven't played it since, but I wasn't. My brother was the board gamer,
right?
So I really only played with him. And just recently, I've tried to get more board games. Like I bought a few myself. I played with some friends a couple weeks ago, and so I'm trying to get back into it, but. Yeah, I haven't played that one in a long time. Like most board games, I haven't played in a long time.
We'll have to remedy that.
Yeah. But yeah, thank you for listening to our podcast. This was a great episode. I liked this one. We talked a lot
good
about
times.
Yeah, good Daredevil discussion. It was great having you involved in the fan casting. That was awesome.
Ugh, it was exhausting.
Yeah, it is. That's why last week I was like, I don't have anything quite done, and this one I had to rush because we wanted to get it done this week, so it's hard. But yeah, it was great getting you involved in that. And next week will be great because we're going to be talking Batman v Superman.
Absolutely.
Which is projected to make tons of money.
It'll get my dollar.
Yeah, it'll get my $10, whatever the tickets are nowadays. Definitely not 3D. I hate 3D.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of 3D myself.
I hate it. I
wouldn't say I hate it. I just don't think it does anything for me.
Yeah, which is why I never see a movie in 3D anymore because it doesn't add anything to the movie.
Well, it adds $3.
Yeah.
That's what it does.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't like it. But yeah, next week should be a great episode talking about that. We'll have more, hopefully more movie news, board game news, spotlight on a board game, and our spotlight will be on Batman v Superman. We're both definitely going to go see it.
Absolutely.
So please like, comment, and subscribe on our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/user/MovieMasterMike. and on our SoundCloud account, which is soundcloud.com/geekquilibrium. We are on Facebook. We are at facebook.com/geekquilibrium and facebook.com/geekquilibrium1. Like, comment, subscribe, support us. The more support we get, the more we can do, because we want to definitely get this podcast on other platforms, such as iTunes eventually, but it all costs money, so we're not quite there yet, but we hope to be. I definitely hope to be.
Yeah, I love doing this.
Oh, me too. It's so much fun just
speaking geek.
Yeah, speaking geek with each other. With hope we can get some people, other people involved.
Absolutely.
So tune in next week, and until then, we are your hosts, Movie Master Mike,
Tabletop Tim,
reminding you to speak your geek
and balance your geek
with Geekquilibrium.